tops of stockings was looked down as something shocking. Now, heaven knows anything goes. Good authors, too, who once knew better words, now only use four-letter words, writing prose. Anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and day's night today, when most guys today that women prize today are just silly gigolos. So though I'm not a great romancer, I know that I'm bound to answer when you propose. Anything goes.
Good evening. As of late, many people have been inquiring as to what exactly the Emerald City is all about. Well, where is it coming from and where is it going? It seems our subject matter varies so much from week to week that some people have become slightly confused as to exactly where our priorities lie. Although we maintain that the program is gay-oriented, one would have to be gay just to figure that out. One week we can be gay and political, and then the next week seem nonpartisan and theatrical. This is all due to the fact that the Emerald City is not so much about gay people as it is for gay people. The bottom line here is that we're trying to make the program as diversified as possible in order to cater to a variety of tastes. So if we've yet to hit upon your particular taste, please drop us a line and we'll attempt to do something about that. I'd like to stop here and congratulate one of Emerald City's latest sponsors, Jan Wallman's Restaurant, who only last week received a very honorable mention in the Going Out Guide of the New York Times. The only thing that the review neglected was the food. The food is some of the best in New York City, never mind the village. So if you're in the neighborhood, please drop by and say hello to Jan. We have only one guest on the program this evening, or actually two. Gracing your screen shortly, Vito Russo, a name prominent in both straight and gay journalistic circles, will be speaking with filmmaker John Waters. Many things have been said of Mr. Waters' films. Some feel that they are shocking, absurd, awful, terrific, and always in the worst possible taste. Mr. Waters first brought Divine and Company to the great screen, his own version of the Mercury Players. Among his triumphs are Female Trouble, Multiple Maniacs, Mondo Trasho, and his most famous film, for which he himself labeled an exercise in poor taste, Pink Flamingos. John is currently in town with his latest release, Desperate Living, from which we'll be showing you some film clips later. And that's all on tap for this evening. Next week, we have a truly special guest on the program. We have the first and only interview in the United States ever done with Quentin Crisp, the real naked civil servant. The interview is truly one of a kind and must be seen, so please come back for that. I'd like to remind you once again to support our sponsors. They're the people that make this all possible. And on that note, we'll break here for a commercial, and we'll be right back with Vito Russo and John Waters after this. Stay tuned.
Just an hour and a half away in Atlantic City, New Jersey, is the most all-inclusive gay complex in the Northeast. The Grand Central Resort features over 175 beautiful rooms, including penthouse suites. And just an elevator ride away, the Showbiz Lounge with spectacular stage shows, the After Dark Piano Bar, Atlantic City's famous M&M Disco, and right on the premises, Club Baths Atlantic City. Right off the boardwalk, the Grand Central Resort in Atlantic City. For reservations, call 609-344-1922. Come on down. The Grand Central Resort is no gamble.
You may find it difficult locating Jan Wallman's, but the best things in life aren't always easy to find. Jan Wallman's, 28 Cornelia Street, where 6th Avenue meets West 4th. Jan Wallman's, fine food in a fine setting.
evening. I'm Vito Russo, and I'm here with John Waters, the writer, producer, and director of such films as Pink Flamingos, Female Trouble, and now in town with his new release, Desperate Living. Hello, welcome to Emerald City. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about how you started making films in Baltimore.
Right.
And why did you start to make films in Baltimore?
Well, even as a child, I was always obsessed by film. I think the first film I saw was Cinderella and then The Wizard of Oz, but I only really liked the evil characters in them. That was the one I was really obsessed by. So then in the early 60s, when underground films first came out, like the early films of the Kuchar brothers and stuff, I used to run away to New York to go see them. And then I had a girlfriend that worked in a camera store, and she stole all the film for me and a camera, and so we made the first movie, and then she would get it developed for free. So that's kind of how it started, by ill-gotten gains.
Were you always, you and Divine friends from high school?
Well, yeah. Divine lived right up the street from my parents. She was the girl next door, sort of.
The girl next door.
Right.
And Divine has been in all of your films?
Except the very first one. Which was called Hag in a Black Leather Jacket, and I made that when I was about 16. But Divine was in the next one, the next one was The Roman Candles. And in that, she was just a starlet then. You know, she was young and just getting into it. Then I made one called Eat Your Makeup, where Divine played Jackie Kennedy with a full Kennedy assassination, with Divine in the, you know, pillbox hat and everything, crawling over the back of the convertible. And that's when she really started to get into it, after that performance, I think.
Did the makeup come then? The Divine makeup?
No, I think that started with Mondo Trasher. That was the first time she was sort of a blonde bombshell in springalators and gold pants and stuff. And the blonde hair. And that was the first one when she really looked like that. And then from then on, we just kept exaggerating it further and further. And eventually, Van Smith took over the makeup and the whole look of Divine.
Right, right. What was the first reaction, not necessarily to your early films, but I think that the really incredible reaction came with Pink Flamingos.
Right. Well, before that, I used to travel around the country with multiple maniacs in the trunk of my car and go to towns and get the newspapers and look at the theater that had the most off-the-wall stuff, and then go try to talk them into letting me show at midnight.
Right.
Sometimes it worked, sometimes I didn't, but I learned a whole lot about film distribution. Mainly, you can't do it yourself. But I had this woman one time in Los Angeles that said, "Mr. Waters, we have carpets on the floor." And I didn't know what she meant by that. And then I realized that she meant somebody might vomit, you know. And I told her that if someone vomited, that would be like a standing ovation. And she got very upset, you know. But then Pink Flamingos finally did open here at the Elgin at midnight. Yeah. We had shown it a couple times in Baltimore and in Provincetown. And we knew that the reaction was very incredible, but the distributor wasn't sure exactly how to open it. And I remember when he told me to come to New York and sign the contract, he said, "Come, but don't bring your friends." You know, he thought maybe we would really be like that, like the people in the films, you know, we're going to come and, you know, come and carry Carrie in the office or something.
You told me that there was a man on one of your college tours who asked you if you still lived in a trailer.
Yeah, it's not documentaries, you know. It always seems surprising that people, when they meet myself or any of the people in it, say, "God, you're not like the characters in the films." Well, we'd all be in prison if we were.
How did you get together with this cast of characters? I mean, people have suggested to me that perhaps in Baltimore there's a bar like the one in Star Wars where all of your characters hang out.
Well, there has been at times, but I met them before we were in bars because we were all like 16. I think we were all sort of the outcasts of all the school system around where we live, so we all sort of banded together. And we never hung around the suburbs where we grew up. We always went downtown and would come to New York.
Right.
And so we just sort of stuck together, I mean, and sort of created this whole thing, sort of just came out of that. And Baltimore, if you've ever been there, it was really the hairdo capital of the world. I mean, you still see people with beehives and Courage boots and everything. And to me, they look freakier than any so-called freak looked in the 60s.
Yeah.
I mean, so we just took that look and kept exaggerating it.
You had lots of trouble with the censorship board in Maryland, didn't you?
Well, anybody would have trouble with the censorship board in Maryland. I mean, it's three women. Well, it was. Now it's a man. There's a man on it. But she says things to me like, "Get a haircut," when I had long hair. I feel like saying, "Well, take that pantsuit off and that wig hat." You know? But she watches the films three at once because she can't cut dialogue. She can only cut because of the First Amendment. And she sits with a microphone and yells to this like retarded projectionist, "Cunnilingus, reel one, rear entry." That was my favorite when she said rear entry. You know? And then so I had to argue with her, and she stopped the film with a pointer and would say, "Now, in Female Trouble, there was a scene where a woman was sitting up on a man's face, but you couldn't see anything except her ass, you know?"
Right.
And she said, "She can sit there, but she can't move." You know, and she's incredible. She says, why don't you make The Sound of Music? Who would see these films? You know, I mean, and it sounds real funny, but when you deal with her, if you say anything, she says, don't break bad with me. And she calls you huge, you know, and you think, what?
has she actually cut your films?
Oh, yes. Yeah, she cut 10 minutes of Pink Flamingo. She cut 1 foot in Female Trouble, which made no difference. Nobody would even be able to tell. Right. But it ruins the whole print. It makes a sound jump, and they have terrible projectors. So you give them a brand new print, and comes back with a scratch on it and everything. And she stopped it from showing at the University of Maryland when she has a sixth grade education. Really, that's as far as she went. And she can control what college students see in the state of Maryland, which is completely ridiculous.
Incredible.
I mean, they were all appointed by Agnew and Mandel and all the wonderful politicians that have come from Maryland.
Right. Do you get the kinds of reactions that you get from her? I don't suppose you get in every city. Because
I think the reaction, the whole point I'm trying to do is just make people laugh. I'm just trying to make a comedy. And generally, that's the reaction I get. That's why they play. I mean, the few people that run out of the theater offended, I don't know why they even go, because what do they think of Pink Flamingos as a wildlife documentary or something? I mean, if it says right in the ad, you know, exercise in poor taste.
You had some trouble with your ad for Desperate Living, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, the New York Times refused to run the ad. Our ad was a formal play setting with a plate with a rat on it. Well, the Times accepted that, you know, it wasn't that they were putting the movie down, but they said that they would not show a rat because it was offensive to the New York Times readers. Well, they show Stacy Moskowitz's bloody body. They showed the ad for Food of the Gods, which was a rat eating a girl. I guess you just can't do a reversal and, you know, think that, imply that a human would
people
eat a rat.
People can't eat rats, but rats can eat people.
So then they ran this other ad. To me, it was much more tasteless. It was Liz Renee with a lot of cleavage and makeup screaming, you know. So I don't get that at all. I mean, it was totally, I wasn't expecting that. A rat, I mean, how could that a rat offend New Yorkers?
Yeah, especially New Yorkers.
Yeah.
Do you have, how tightly scripted are your films? Do people have a good time in ad lib, or do you really stick real close?
It's completely written and rehearsed. We rehearse it for like about sometimes 3 or 4 weeks before we shoot it, because that's the only way we can do it on such a small budget.
Mm-hmm.
It's just work. I mean, when we go there, we start at 6 in the morning, and sometimes we don't finish till 2 in the morning. And a lot of people, when they see my films, think everybody's stoned, but it's nothing like that, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's because you can't do it. I mean, there's too many technical problems.
Yeah, it's like people used to say that the Disney animators were always stoned when they were doing Cinderella. It's impossible.
Yeah.
People can't do that kind of work if they're stoned.
It's made just like a conventional movie. I mean,
what's the you said before that people seem to think that you live the way you look in your movies. Does that reaction, I remember you were telling me you were on tour with Edie, and some guy said,
one of the questions was, is that Edith's real face? Which I never quite figured, what do you think, it was a Halloween mask or something? And Edie didn't seem to be, she said, yeah, it is. You know, but it was a very strange question, I thought.
Yeah.
I mean,
people sort of expect Divine to walk down the street wearing that all the time.
Divine called that her work clothes, you know, I mean, it's too much trouble, it takes hours to get into that. Plus, it's uncomfortable with all those bras and everything. You know?
Does it surprise you when gay people find your films offensive, as opposed to sort of, I don't mean to categorize them, but as opposed to sort of middle-of-the-road straight people?
Well, no, because they're just with gay people, there's middle-of-the-road, there's conservative. I mean, it doesn't really surprise me at all. I haven't had that much of a bad reaction from any gay thing. There was one in a Boston gay paper, I just read a review that said how we expected to laugh at this kind of thing. We've learned our lesson. I never quite got what he was talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're going to have to break just for a minute for a few commercials, and we'll be right back with John Waters.
Keep good memories with good music. You'll find it all at Happy Tunes. Happy Tunes, 53 West 8th Street in the Village.
Now is the time to visit the world's largest emporium of erotica. Come, experience New York's most extensive selection of adult magazines, films, and paperbacks. 250 Book Center and GNA Books. No matter what you're seeing, if it's the finest in visuals you're after, we've got it all. Two locations in Manhattan. 250 Book Center at 250 West 42nd Street. GNA Bookstore located at 251 West 42nd Street. Come on over. You never know who you might bump into.
Wouldn't you like to get out of the city once in a while? Are you tired of the same old places, the same old faces? Wouldn't you like a place that wasn't too far away, but just far enough? A place where movies are shown twice a week, where you can play pool or pinball with friends or just friendly strangers. If this sounds like your kind of place, make headway for Billy the Kid in Jackson Heights, Queens. Take the BMT to 76th Street. We're located directly under the L at 7607 Roosevelt Avenue in Jackson Heights. Billy the Kid, come on.
Hello, if you've just joined us, I'm Vito Russo, and I'm sitting here with John Waters, the director of the new film, Desperate Living. One of the things about Desperate Living that I've noticed is, well, first of all, the ads describe Desperate Living as a monstrous comedy or a fairy tale about lesbianism, mental anguish, and political corruption. What enticed you to make a fairy tale about those subjects?
Well, I always liked fairy tales as a kid, you know, and I just had done so many films in location in Baltimore. I wanted to do something completely on set, you know. Mm-hmm. So to do it like that, rather than show a normal city, we wanted to build this special town, which is Mortville, which is supposedly the worst place you can possibly live in the world. I mean, everybody's living there in total mortification under rule of this lunatic queen that worships Idi Amin. So, I mean, it sort of had to be in a fantasy place. I mean, you couldn't really set that up in location.
Right.
And I just, all the aspects of a fairy tale appealed to me. It was something I'd never done before.
This is your first film without Divine.
Right.
Do you miss Divine?
Oh, I missed working with Divine, yeah, because Divine knew exactly what I wanted. And Divine was always very professional to work with and very good for the morale of everybody.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it was kind of fun to work with some new people. You know, we used a lot of new people this time. So, I have feelings both ways about it. I'd probably make another film with Divine.
Would you?
Yeah.
Yeah. I was wondering where you got, how did you approach Liz Renee, who used to be the moll of gangster Mickey Cohen?
Right. Well, I read her book called My Face for the World to See, which cracked me up when I read it. And then I read that she had streaked Hollywood Boulevard, and she is 51 years old, so I did give her a little credit for that. And then she beat the rap in a full jury trial. Then she had a mother-daughter strip act, so I went to see her. And then I went to see her in Los Angeles, and we went out to the Brown Derby, and I signed her up, the perfect cliche deal, you know. And I knew she was going to be good, because to our meeting, she wore at 12 o'clock in the afternoon a floor-length pink evening gown. So I figured, well, I think, you know, she could handle it. And she was great to work with. You know, there's one scene where she's nude with live roaches crawling all over, and she just said, okay. You know, it was very cooperative. She got along especially well with Edith.
Did she?
Yeah.
Oh, that figures.
Right.
How does your family react? Have they seen Desperate Living yet?
No, they haven't seen it. I get along very well with my parents. Matter of fact, the whole beginning scene is my mother's house, and she let us break her antique glass and everything, so I thought that was pretty nice of her. But they never go to the movies, and they say, if you want us to come see this, we'll come. But why put them through it? You know, they left Mondo Trasho in tears, you know. So I figured that why put them through it? I mean, they're very supportive on everything, but if they would never come see it. They'd maybe see one movie a year, Silver Streak or something.
Right.
You know? It would certainly never pick Desperate Living as a film to come see. Mm. So why push it? You know?
Yeah, yeah. We're going to be seeing a film clip from Desperate Living. If you'll look up at your monitors right now, it'll be up there on your screen.
Hey, you listen to me, wacko! See this fist? I'm about ready to use that hatchet face of yours as a punching bag. Now sit down and shut up! Mole's right, Peggy. I am sick of listening to your bitching. The next time you feel a fit coming on, go outside and bitch. Bitch at the air, bitch at the trees, but don't bitch at us.
My bitching isn't relieved if there's no one to hear it.
Well, we can't all be your psychiatrist, honey. We've got problems of our own.
Well, why are you in Mortville?
Oh, it's a long, ugly story. Go ahead, Muffy, tell her. Maybe she'd stop feeling sorry for herself.
I wasn't always like this. Oh, I mean, of course I was always visually stunning. But I was married to a man, and I had a baby named Freddie. It was about 2 years ago, and my husband and I were just returning from a cocktail party.
Drive.
Get off! I can drive. Always trying to boss me around.
You're drunk, as per usual.
Ah.
Every time we step
drinks, you get dead drunk.
When you're married to a nag, a man's gotta drink.
First I have to be mortified in front of our friends. Now I have to be mortified in front of the babysitter. I suppose I'll have to drive her home.
I'll take her.
Yeah, you'll take her straight to the graveyard. Let me drive!
Get off, I'll take her.
Would you like to tell us a little bit about that scene? Did you,
Well, that scene's really a flashback in the whole movie. It's one of the characters telling why she ended up in Mortville.
I want to know how you got the baby in the refrigerator.
A lot of people give me a lot of grief about that. Said, how could you put that baby in the refrigerator? We didn't chill it for a week or anything. It was only in there for a second, you know. I don't think it's going to grow up and only be able to have sex in refrigerators or something, you know. The people whose house that we filmed in got a little upset. They said, what's the baby for? And we said, well, put it in the refrigerator. But the baby didn't seem to mind that much. He came to the opening in Baltimore, and he didn't even recognize that it was himself in the film. But we had to go back and get wild sound of the baby crying, which was really ridiculous, because we had to say, like, there's ghosts in here. Your mother's leaving. The baby would just look at it, you know,
for
hours.
What about the baby's mother? Did the baby's mother know?
Yeah, the baby's mother volunteered. I thought I would have a hard time. She said, my baby will do it, you know. But it was only in there for maybe 3 seconds. I mean, Liz came in, opened the refrigerator door, and it was in there. And the rest of the crying was all dubbed in later. It went right off the set and everything. And that was the scene where Liz was kind of uptight because she had to drown the girl in the dog food. Mm-hmm. And we had to do so many takes because Liz was uptight to really push her head. And the girl was, she said, come on, do it, so we only have to do it once, you know. But Liz kept not, it looked fake, you know. So we had to keep doing it over and more gravy train, you know.
Does it matter to you, do the reviews of your films matter to you at all?
Well, I never believe a filmmaker that says I don't read my reviews. Of course I read them. And, I mean,
people are really horrified by this stuff a lot of the time, and they don't even take the film, they don't even take the film seriously.
Yeah. Well, it all depends. I mean, you can get some kind of reviews that are very bad reviews that just make people go see it that are funny. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I think Rex Reed said about our last film, where do these people come from? Where do they go when the sun goes down? Isn't there a law or something? Well, I thought that was funny, you know. I think we put it in the ads. But it just totally depends. I mean, some reviews hurt sometimes, sure.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, you just, that's part of it.
Do they make money?
Yeah. I mean, Pink Flamingos made the most money. Female Troubles made a little. The other ones have all made some, you know. Mm-hmm.
You are spending more and more money on every film.
Right.
This latest film, you've reconstructed Reconstruction City, only making it look worse than it looked originally.
Resurrection
City. And are you wanting to spend more and more money on
film? Well, each time we've doubled the budget. So each time we've learned from our past mistakes and been able to get technically better and have more equipment and everything, sure, each time we want to make it look better because it's easier to watch.
You know, is that all you want to do? Continue to make films?
I just want to make comedies, right?
What do you have plans for another one after Desperate Living?
What I'd really like to do next is make a film in Smell-O-Vision starring Annette Funicello. But I think I might have a hard time because she just won the Catholic Mother of the Year award, and I read a review of her where she said that the reason she doesn't make movies anymore is because she gets scripts and they ask her on the second page to smoke marijuana. I thought, well, if she's uptight about doing that, you know, I can't picture doing one of my films.
Well, thanks for talking to us today.
Really?
Good luck with the film. I think it's wonderful.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon.
All righty.
Thank you.
A very special thanks to John Snell for his contributions in both video and time to this program. Also thanks to Tom Ellis and Walter Kent of the Beacon Baths for their continued support. This tape was edited at Technosphere. Good night.